Chapter 39, Time and Forever. As we approach the end of our look at Buddhism and spiritual path, it's fitting to consider the greatest paradox of all, our time-bound lives set in the context of eternity. As you may have noticed, the second half of this book has treated two major topics. One, the cosmic plan and spiritual path, and two, the practical ways of self-healing and balance. While the first topic presents the basic metaphysics of creation and its design, and the latter shares the how-tos of personal growth, the greater context behind all this is easy to miss, as it is exceedingly subtle and usually forgotten. What is this greater context? In the Buddhist tradition, it's sometimes presented through the filter of relative versus absolute view. This dichotomy is no less than time and forever, or, to be more specific, the irony of having to work on ourselves while our ever-present true nature is absolutely perfect and needs no work at all. In discussing the metaphysics of self, Ra points to this same so-called paradox, which is, however, no paradox at all to them, nor to enlightened beings or higher self. As an element of their more advanced teachings, the practice is only effective after one has already learned the basics of how to know, accept, and love our own personal patterns. Quote, the seeker seeks the one, and the one is to be sought by the balanced and self-accepting entity, aware of both its apparent distortions and its total perfection. Resting in this balanced awareness, the entity then opens itself to the universe, which it is. End quote. This kind of self-reflection is best achieved through the various practices of formless, non-doing type meditation, like watching the breath, in typical Buddhist fashion, as we have discussed in previous chapters. But formal practice or not, Ra's statement points to the fundamental reality of self, the dichotomy between relative and absolute. This is the heart and blood of the relationship between time and forever, or in other words, the obvious passage of our daily lives in physical form set in the matrix of eternity, the infinite being we always are. Again, if you've not tasted the bliss of being free of becoming, or glimpsed the vast expanse of seeing free of grasping, you will not really know what I'm talking about. But if you do have an inkling of what I mean, it is quite useful to unpack some of what's going on here. This will also be a nice summation of some of the important ideas already presented. We start with a rather advanced consideration of cosmic metaphysics, or, in other words, what in the world is life all about? So, let's begin at the beginning. The ordinary, common folks we call ourselves, Tom, Dick, Harry, and Jane, are really embodied expressions of a higher self, who is itself a being of sixth density, fully aware of oneness with all. To use non-technical terms, your source is total perfection, and you are never separate from that source. You are higher self, and higher self is really you. But, and here's the catch, in time and space, which includes third, fourth, fifth, and early sixth dimensions, plus all the ETs likely to show up on the 500-channel TV, we're not able to live our true identity. As we all know, we live but a fraction of our whole potential. However, it's quite understandable. Our whole potential is infinity. So, let's ask the really big question. Why does higher self, which is itself an expression of the boundless creator, infinite awareness, and energy, why does it need to take form at all? Why does it need to incarnate in a fleshy body, or even in a light body? Why is there this long, hard path of evolution in the first place? What is the point of forgetting who you are and what you are, only to work throughout the eons to simply regain what was never lost in the first place? What's the point of all this travail? As the primary paradox, Eastern mystics have tried to explain this unexplainable. Hindus call it lila, play or dance, and some Buddhists call it tatata, suchness or as it isness, both from Sanskrit. In the final analysis, the mind of God is inscrutable. Creation exists just because it's a good thing that it does. But why? I can only imagine that some kind of greater glory comes from infinite experience, though it really does not have to be at all. Where does all this high philosophy take us? Well, it depends on how much you can really take it in, how much you really know that you are God. This is not a call to spiritual inflation, nor pride, nor ego. Remember, there are countless souls farther along the so-called path than you or I. Knowing God goes far deeper than intellect, which is quite shallow anyway. The knowing I am talking about is manifest in a confidence that feels no need to hurry, since time is endless, and after this life comes another and yet another, going from home to home. It manifests in self-trust that does not mind playing or wasting time, being indulgent or being strict, since all desires must be tasted fully somehow to fully be transmuted. It's manifest in a broad self-kindness, willing to accept and forgive, putting a stop to inner struggle and self-punishment. It manifests as faith, peace, and true inner resting. What you choose to do with your life on earth is your own business. The higher self, ever at ease, pulls no strings and holds no grudges. In its own dual attention, in towards matter and out towards spirit, higher self does all it can to arrange the basic conditions we may use to grow. It also waits for the calling, just like the patient elder ETs who observe the law of free will and serve only beings who seek their aid. All such old souls know the path and the greater cosmic plan. They know their God nature and live at one. And lest we forget, they are not far away, which is just the point. Time and forever are not a paradox at all. To say that we live, quote, time-bound lives set in the context of eternity, end quote, is a nice spiritual phrase, but it's actually just a concept. As a label pinned to experience, this type of thinking is just another illusion to be shattered along the way. Time and forever are not two separate things. Right before your very eyes lives a mystery far greater than words or thought can capture. It cannot be fully met by logic or reason, nor by trance or psychedelia. True infinity is not only seen through telescopes on starry, starry nights. Living vivid enlightenment, awareness of infinity, is not separate from form and the so-called 3D illusion. As we roll into the next decade and harvest, i.e. global ascension into fourth density life, I think the fusion of time and forever will become more and more obvious. Many have said, and many are now feeling, the thinning of the veil between matter and spirit, the physical and non-physical in close approach. As Earth fills its etheric grid with more and more fourth density energy, the forces of love, and a gateway to higher life, we'll see increasing signs of magic, mystery, and the sacred around us. While U.S. politics go from bad to worse, and if you think recent scandals were bad, just wait, and world conflicts simmer, those of us with open eyes and hearts may enjoy the best years of our lives. By that, I mean the best years of our total series of Earth lives. As the last go-round for almost all wanderers, I think we may well go out with a bang. For while global power games intensify, we really can start to live a heaven on Earth right here and now, even before the dawn of fourth density, whenever that may be. Heaven, joy, and the worlds of light have never been closer than they are today. As always, it all depends on us and how we use the resources available. Before he died, the Buddha reminded his circle that life is unstable and no one knows the time of death, and so we ought to be diligent in meditation. Not too tight, not too loose, neither tense nor slack. This is the way to keep our seeking fresh. It's also good advice to help us stay balanced as we journey through the last years of a messy cycle of Earth human life. There will be challenges galore, but as always, it's just grist for the mills of love, wisdom, and will. And what else are we here for? Though I'm not yet ready to go the way of the Buddha, I do have some words of wisdom in closing. Above all else, take full responsibility for your life and your daily state of mind. They are wholly your creation. Do not forget that you alone determine the speed of your spiritual unfoldment. And finally, know that the very friction of human life is a rare opportunity, not always available.